Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another Live at 5. I am your curator, Kevin Adkisson, with the Cranbrook Center for Collections and Research. And today I am coming to you live from the, at the moment, the inverse of the Cranbrook swimming pool, the actual excavated earth that made the swimming pool. But we are going to be heading down to the Cranbrook Williams Natatorium, a gift of Betty Williams, the longtime chairwoman of the Cranbrook Academy of Art, and her husband, in honor of the Williams family, including their two sons and daughter. And if you know the name Williams Natatorium, you might also make the connection that it was designed by Todd Williams and Billy Sin. Now, Todd and Billy are a husband and wife team of architects trained at Princeton and practicing out of New York, for a long time practicing out of Carnegie Hall, where they lived and worked in the apartments above Carnegie Hall. The Cranbrook Williams Natatorium is a pretty remarkable building. It's a place that I include on most of my tours of the Cranbrook campus because it is really a very special piece of architecture. It opened to the public and to the Cranbrook community in 1999, and we are walking down to it from Cranbrook Academy of Art and Cranbrook Art Museum along this beautiful, long, grassy lawn. And this is a east-west axis that connects all the way from the natatorium right here, and then it swoops back alongside Cranbrook School and Gordon Hall of Science, past the Cranbrook School Boys Dormitory, all the way up to the Art Museum on the hill. And then if I step out a little bit, you can see that here is the Ramp of the Chinese Dog, which is a stairway with a Chinese lion. And then it continues on straight across to George Booth's office at Cranbrook House. And so when the architects set out to build the new Cranbrook swimming pool, it was part of a larger master plan developed by Todd Williams, Billy Sin Architects, for an entire reimagining of the Cranbrook Athletic Complex. It was developed in the early 1990s. Todd and Billy had been approached to build a building at Cranbrook as early as 1990, when they were asked to submit a proposal for Brookside School in the around 1990. They were deemed to be essentially too minimalist, too kind of high architecture for Brookside, and of course that commission ended up going to Peter Rose. Next, Todd and Billy designed a competition entry for the new entrance to Cranbrook on Woodward Avenue, and that design was rejected as being too retro. They said it looked like a 1960s gas station and not like a Cranbrook project of the 1990s. Todd and Billy were then approached to build an addition to the Institute of Science, but it was thought that Stephen Hull was a better fit. And so finally, Todd and Billy get the commission to do a master plan of the entire athletic complex. And if you're interested in that proposal, I'm not sure how much of it is online, but I did do a lecture about the athletic complex, and I know that it is free on YouTube. And so if you just search History of American Architecture, Cranbrook in Context, Week 5, you could see my whole lecture. Today, though, we are going to talk about the only part of the Todd Williams, Billy Sin, TWTBA architects proposal that was completed, and that is the natatorium behind me. And specifically, we are going to be focusing on the bricks of the natatorium, in part because I don't think that we can go inside the natatorium today, but hopefully on a Live at 5 in the near future. It is kind of amazing that we have been doing this for over a year and a half and we've never toured the natatorium together, but for most of the pandemic, the pool was closed and then it was under renovation. I, though, am building up anticipation with you all, my loyal followers and viewers, for an upcoming lecture that I'm doing, Uncovering Cranbrook, the Bricks of Cranbrook. And this is going to be a lecture on Monday, October 25th at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m. Eastern Time. And I'm going to be exploring the bricks of Cranbrook that Albert Kahn used at Cranbrook House, that Aliel Saarinen used in our buildings, and the bricks that Todd Williams and Billy Chin use here at the Natatorium. So we finally approach the building. I've sort of set up the fact that Todd Williams and Billy Chin, that Todd Williams himself is not only an alumni of the schools, but that his family were deeply involved in the leadership and support of Cranbrook and in the creation of this building. It is the only part of the master plan that was realized, and it is, I think, one of the best buildings that Cranbrook built in, as part of its millennium projects. Now, it is interesting as a building because most of it is actually buried out of sight on this slope here. And so most of the pool, the actual swimming facility itself, is in this warehouse-like building off to the side. And the axial relationship, which you can see this sort of long lawn up to the art museum, is then the sort of power of the axis is coming back and jamming right behind me. And so the architects really viewed this intersection, this sort of zipper of bricks, as resulting from all of that sort of momentum of the axis that is established by George Booth in 1908, continued by Aliel Saarinen throughout the 1920s to the 1940s, and finally a building worthy of finishing the axis opens in 1999. And so you see the way that the two brick walls seem to be dented, pushed back. That is the dead center of the axis. And what's actually behind this is a little bit unremarkable. It's actually a ramp that connects the level of where I'm standing with the level of the pool deck. And what is amazing about this brick wall are these glazed bricks. Now, glazed bricks have been used since ancient time, and especially on your computer or your phone, this really beautiful blue color, this teal color, may remind you of sort of Persian architecture, architecture of the Fertile Crescent. I've never been to the Middle East, but I've seen at the Pergamon Museum many glazed brick examples in Berlin. There's some at the British Museum, some at the Met. And so there's sort of this ancient quality to the use of teal glazed brick. But by 1999, when this building opens, it's really a very unusual product to use. And there's really one very famous example of glazed brick in the 20th century that Todd and Billy are looking at when they design this building, and that's the General Motors Technical Center by Aero Saarinen. I think it's interesting that the architects are referencing a building by the Saarinen family that is not a Cranbrook building, but of course the GM Tech Center, completed in the 1950s, is a sort of seminal example of American modern architecture and a very important project from Aero Saarinen, the son of our founding architect, Aliel Saarinen. And so Todd and Billy decide that they will use glazed brick as this sort of reference, this callback to Aero Saarinen's architecture. When it comes to the color of the glazed brick, at the GM Tech Center, it was a consultation between Alexander Girard, Aero Saarinen, and the head of Cranbrook's ceramics department, Maya Grotel. Now, Maya Grotel was a Finnish-American who worked at Cranbrook from the mid-30s to the mid-60s, and she's famous for her Grotel blue. And that blue color is this that her pots were made out of, her vessels, was then used by the architects. They used Grotel's glaze recipe from Cranbrook archives to create the blue brick that you see here. But what are all of these spots? This is a very interesting both physical property and an interesting demand from the architects. The physical property, these are manganese iron spots. And so manganese, or you know, what makes iron magnetic, is a feature of many bricks, and it will turn a brick, it will give it dark spots as part of the firing process. You can think of bricks as essentially, you know, fired clay like a ceramic pot, or fired like terracotta. It's all the same material. It is earth that is given a very high heat, and then the reaction or the solidification occurs because of the kiln. Now, what else happens in the kiln is that if there are any mineral deposits within the brick, they will cause a reaction. And so these are manganese deposits that are creating all of these lovely little flecks. And what's amazing about our glazed brick is that the manganese is coming through the glaze. And this was extraordinarily difficult to achieve technically. And so these bricks were made by the Endicott Clay Company of Fairbury, Nebraska, who are real leaders of American brick making. Most of the America's bricks come from Ohio or the Midwest because of our rich clay deposits. And so Todd Williams and Billy Chin, particularly Billy, was really taking the lead on the brick making. They write to Endicott Clay and they say, "We want glazed bricks, but we want iron spot glazed brick." So why did they want the iron spot and the glazing? They thought it would look too literal if they built a pool and it looked like just a wall of glazed tiles. So if the bricks had been fully glazed, as they are at the GM Tech Center, and as sort of ancient glazed bricks are, they actually can look just like bathroom subway tiles. And so if you couldn't tell that the building was made out of glazed brick, but it looked like it was just made out of glazed tiles, it could look a little bit cheap, like, oh, it's a swimming pool, so we gave it bathroom tiles. And so the architect really demanded that Endicott develop a glaze and firing technique where the manganese, where the iron spot comes through the brick. Now, Endicott kept sending samples to New York, and every time they arrived, the architect rejected them. And Billy would just say, you know, that's not what we want. These look like glazed ceramic tiles. And so finally, Billy Sin and some of the associates from Todd and Billy's office fly down to Nebraska, and they see a stack of bricks that were the reject pile, and they say, hey, that reject brick is the exact brick that we want. And luckily for everyone, Endicott runs a very professional and sort of scientific operation, because ultimately ceramics and brick firing, it is a scientific enterprise of heat and clay. And they have a number on that reject brick, and they say, yeah, we can reverse engineer this. We can make that your brick. And so the brick that had been rejected becomes the cornerstone of our wall. Now, there are two colors of bricks that are glazed here. One is the Grotel blue, which has this really gorgeous aquatic feel. I think it really tells us to anticipate that this is a pool building. And then the other color of brick is this Kingswood green. And this is the distinct teal that Aliel Saarinen uses in the painted bricks at Kingswood. It's also the same copper color that the Kingswood roof will eventually be again, but of course Kingswood, for most of its history, had a very distinct green copper roof. It's also the same teal color that Pipsan Saarinen uses in Kingswood, and that Mary Stratton and the Powabic pottery tiles at Kingswood are all in this same teal. And so this color not only connects us to Cranbrook, it also is meant to represent earth and nature. And so you have the sort of blue tiles of water, you have the teal tiles of the earth, but both of them, whether it's Maya Grotel's signature blue or whether it's Kingswood's teal, they're both really, the color of the glazed brick is really deeply rooted to Cranbrook's history. Now, there is another brick that we can see, the sort of framing brick, which is this gorgeous sort of a purple and brown brick. And this is a Norman style brick, and that just means that it is a longer brick that was popular in the Norman era. Sometimes you'll see these referred to as Roman brick. The difference is that a Roman brick would usually be also flatter. So it's slightly a modern technological distinction because Norman bricks could be the same flatness as a Roman brick. Roman brick were used during the Norman era, but for a modern sort of, if I'm an architect specifying a brick, and I say a Norman brick, I mean that it's going to be the same dimension, the same height as a standard brick, and just longer. And so you'll see if I turn on our corner, that these are a very standard size American brick, and then the bricks right above them are the same height, but a much wider brick. And so these are Norman Iron Spot Purple brick. And one of the beautiful details of all of these brick walls, and I think it's really picking up quite well on our Facebook Live, is that the horizontal mortar lines are raked. And so these are sort of gouged out. And then the vertical mortar line, which is called a purpend, the purpend is kept flush with the brick. So you can see as I move the camera closer to the wall, how it really emphasizes the horizontal and the vertical becomes very minimalized. And that is true of both the glazed brick and the Norman brick. Now, this is a trick, a construction detail. I shouldn't call it a trick. It is a construction detail that was beloved by Frank Lloyd Wright and his prairie style architecture. The Frank Lloyd Wright Smith House does this. Frank Lloyd Wright was using it as a way of emphasizing the horizontality of the building, of making the building seem even lower and closer to the earth. That is the same reason that Todd and Billy use the raked horizontal mortar lines here. And you can see how beautiful it creates these shadow lines on the building. Now, I do plan to come back and do a more full natatorium tour. There are some pieces of the natatorium that I want to show you that require additional help. And so we won't be doing a full natatorium tour today. But since I know how loyal all of you watchers are and how desperate you probably are to see inside, we will just peek inside to the other side of the brick wall and see that in fact the glazed brick continues on the inside of the ramp. And on the outside, remember, it was that blue color, and now on the inside it is the teal color, and we really get a sense of the thinness of the building. So here is that wall that is showing the kind of impact of the axis. So the ramp is kinked and it goes down and back. I had the pleasure of giving Todd and Billy a tour of their masterpiece a few weeks ago, and Todd told me, he said, you know, Kevin, I was a young architect when I did this, and if I did it again, I would just make this room have more purpose. I mean, it's a lot of money, realistically. It's a lot of investment and a lot of sort of space to basically have a ramp be most of what you see. And I was able to perhaps assure him that there is actually a purpose to this ramp. Not only does it provide the accessible way that you're able to get from campus level to pool level, but it's also where, when the pool is in full use, it's where all the children leave their backpacks and clothes. And so it is a sort of massive locker room for when the pool is being used by Brooksiders or other Cranbrook students. Now, inside, we're seeing custom Heath ceramics from Los Angeles, as well as a light shaft coming down that brings light into the boys' locker room. We're also seeing that the predominant material of this side of the pool is rubbed concrete block, and these are custom concrete block. Now, as a general rule, we don't show Cranbrook School students in Live at 5, so I'm not going to linger here at the pool, but just sort of show you the ceiling of it with this amazing star field. And another time we will be able to come back and hopefully do a more detailed tour of the natatorium when it is just us old friends here for Live at 5. Now, again, the reason that we did bricks at the natatorium today for Live at 5, and the reason that we will do bricks next week for Live at 5, is that I have had my head deep in the archives researching the bricks of Cranbrook in anticipation of the relaunch of our popular, dare I say it, Uncovering Cranbrook lecture series. You may remember that I started this lecture series during the pandemic, and we had Uncovering Cranbrook lectures about Studio Loya Saarinen, about Cranbrook and the Bauhaus, about Eero Saarinen and Yale, and a few other topics, Frank Lloyd Wright and Japan. We are relaunching the Uncovering Cranbrook lecture series with a lecture on October 25th at 11 a.m. Eastern and at 7 p.m. Eastern, called The Bricks of Cranbrook. And it is going to be a full, glorious 75 minutes thinking about learning about bricks. And I have some pretty amazing slides already in development about how bricks are made, how they were made historically, how our bricks ended up here at Cranbrook. You are probably going to be surprised to learn that all of our bricks are not even American, which if you think it must be expensive to build a building out of bricks from Europe, you are correct. It is an absurd thing to do, but Cranbrook did it. And so there are just so many wonderful brick stories at Cranbrook, as well as so many interesting ways that bricks have been used to build buildings. So I really am encouraging you to head over to center.cranbrook.edu and buy your ticket right now to the Bricks of Cranbrook lecture. It is also going to have an accompanying tour, a 2-hour behind the scenes tour with yours truly, and we will be wandering through the Academy of Art and the Cranbrook School, as well as over to the Natatorium, looking at bricks, touching bricks, feeling the mortar lines, really getting into it, because I say this often on tours, there are not that many places in the world where one can do an architecture tour and the quality of building architecturally and construction stays at this very high level. And I think the bricks are an interesting way to think about the design and legacy of Cranbrook. So I hope that you will join me on October 25th for that lecture. Again, you can sign up at center.cranbrook.edu. Thanks so much for watching another Live at 5. I hope that you learned a bit more about the Natatorium and how we have continued the legacy of Cranbrook's rich brick architecture from the 1920s into the 1990s, and the sort of efforts and struggles that went into the creation of these really gorgeous glazed brick. The brick program will be available as a recording. However, you know, your support is what allows Cranbrook Center for Collections and Research to stay in operation. It's what allows me to have a job. And so the brick program will be recorded, but it will still be a ticketed event. So even if you can't make it on the 25th, go ahead and purchase your ticket and we will mail you or email you the link. So all of the Uncovering Cranbrook lectures are still ticketed events. I know that's not that popular in the day where so much is free, but this really is the way that we are able to continue to support the work of preservation and education that the Center for Collections and Research provides. I hope you feel that it's worth the ticket price. I know I really appreciate all of you watching our free Live at 5 tours, and I do really appreciate when you are able to also enjoy our ticketed programs. If you are headed over to buy the ticket right now, please, in the comments, do note that you are here because of Live at 5. That does help me and my team know where exactly tickets are coming in from. So if you're watching this video and thinking, wow, I could listen to this guy talk about bricks forever, make sure you comment in the ticket purchase that you are buying it because of Live at 5. And for all of you who have said that you would watch a lecture where I read the phone book, this is a true test of my abilities to market a lecture, because bricks are not exactly the most famous and glamorous thing, but let me tell you, this is gonna be the best lecture you've ever been to in the Uncovering Cranbrook series, because our bricks are really good, really interesting, and really underappreciated. So with that, thanks for joining me for another Live at 5. I will see you next Wednesday for another brick-themed Live at 5. And I'll see you on October 25th for the brick lecture. And then the brick behind-the-scenes tours on campus will be taking place later that week on Friday and the next week on Tuesday. The tours are going to sell out quickly. I think some already have sold out. They are small tours with me looking at bricks. So head over to the center website and learn all about it. If you do get the tour comes with the lecture. You don't need to check out twice. But if you do check out twice, you will join all the other people that we have refunded. Sorry, our website is a little confusing. Thanks so much for watching. I'm Kevin Adkisson with the Cranbrook Center for Collections and Research. Until next time.